M-Y-Z, Z-A-H is to show up, is a T. It's to show up, is a T.
Hey there, fools.
Big T here, and I'm back with another video. In this video, I'll be discussing the upcoming Super Mario Odyssey. Just basically, you know, what I think about its influences and things like that. Before we get started, I just want to give a brief little history regarding Rare and Miyamoto and some issues, I guess you would say, they were having. Basically, you all know that Miyamoto is the creator of Mario and Donkey Kong. Basically, Donkey Kong was his baby. It was the game that got him into Nintendo, the industry, whatnot. So I'm sure it's a character that's near and dear to him. And when the Super Nintendo came out, the character was basically passed on to Rare. Rare had ingratiated themselves with Nintendo by doing a plethora of different types of software and impressing Nintendo. And they got their chance to do a platformer using Donkey Kong, the storied iconic character that Miyamoto created. So I'm sure that alone caused some animosity within Miyamoto, with him and Rare. There was, you know, rumors about Miyamoto's having issues with Rare, kind of throwing pop shots at them after they made Donkey Kong Country. Just, you know, kind of taking shots about the gameplay and how it wasn't that great and just little things like that. So I think, I never thought about it before, but I think that stemmed from how he felt about them taking on his character, and also the fact that it was a ridiculous success of a game. And so I'm sure there was some anger, some animosity there. There was probably a little bit of he was feeling a little bit of pressure, if you will, from what Rare was doing. So I'm sure that had, you know, something to do with it as well. So I just wanted to give that kind of backdrop, because, you know, Miyamoto was a lot younger then. You know, nobody's perfect, nobody's above a little bit of pettiness, and I'm sure that some of that was there. Even the genius that Miyamoto is, probably he's a human being still, so he's susceptible to things like that, just like any other human being. So just wanted to give some backdrop for it, because looking at Mario Odyssey, Super Mario Odyssey, I'm seeing influences from Rare's game Banjo-Kazooie, which is, like I said, because of the backdrop, it's a little bit strange to see Miyamoto, but Koizumi is the I believe he's the director on the game, so most of what's going on there has to do with Koizumi. Miyamoto just kind of like is like the supervisor. They bounce ideas off of him, and he kind of approves or disapproves. Koizumi was the one that came up with the water pack, the flood backpack for Mario and Super Mario Sunshine. If you didn't know, that was Koizumi's idea. Miyamoto liked it, and so they kind of built the game around that. For the most part, Miyamoto isn't the creative designer, creative director on the game. So maybe where Koizumi doesn't have that kind of animosity towards Rare or what they did in the past, he doesn't mind borrowing from great platformers. And surprisingly, a lot of Nintendo fans haven't played the Banjo-Kazooie series. It was one of my favorite platformers on the Nintendo 64, which is my favorite console of all time. I will be doing a Banjo-Kazooie versus Super Mario 64 versus video before the launch of Super Mario Odyssey, and so that's going to be a part of it. Basically, I guess you could say this is a part of a series of games or a series of videos I'm doing in commemoration for Super Mario Odyssey. So basically just wanted to talk about that capture mechanic, or the some people have dubbed it the possession mechanic. I don't think Nintendo likes that, because it invokes like religious stuff, maybe. You know, possession is like demons possessing somebody or something, so they want to stay away from that. They look at it as capture, and for me that mechanic is very similar to one of the core mechanics in Banjo-Kazooie, which was going to Mumbo Jumbo, the character who's the magical shaman, and going to him and having him transform you into a different animal or some kind of object that you need to progress in the game and collect more jiggies. And you know, the capture mechanic is seems like a huge mechanic for Super Mario Odyssey, where you become other animals or other characters in the game to progress and do stuff you couldn't do before capturing, you know. Those things are very similar. And you can say, well, you know, Mario games, you know, in the past he's become Tanuki and things like that, so it's not something that they took from Banjo-Kazooie. But I do think it has some influences on it. Obviously, one of the newer mechanics in this Mario game is that once you collect a moon, which is basically like a star from the previous Mario games, you can continue going. It doesn't pull you out of the game, basically the way it did in Super Mario Sunshine or Super Mario 64 or Galaxy. You don't get pulled out of the level and have to start again and start, you know, a specific quest for a specific moon. And that is something that Banjo-Kazooie did way back, you know, in 1998, where you collect the Jiggy and you just keep going. You know, you can collect all the Jiggies on one run in the game if you're able to, because sometimes some Jiggies in a level require a specific ability that you may not have learned yet, and you might pick up in a later world, so you might have to come back. But that's something that Banjo-Kazooie has always done. And so for me, I feel like it's pulling from that mechanic from Banjo-Kazooie as well. But also there's more specific things. Like I said before, Mario has transformed into bees and all this stuff and whatnot in Galaxy games. But again, that Galaxy is after Banjo-Kazooie. And you could say before that, like I said, Tanuki, Mario, and all that stuff, he could turn into a statue and things like that. But that didn't really progress. It didn't really tie into the gameplay, whereas you needed to do these things to collect the main bounty from each level, which is a shine sprite, a star, or a moon. And that is obviously the case in Mario Galaxy or Mario Odyssey, is that you need to do these transformations or capturing to progress further in the game to get all the moons and stuff. So there's that. But there's one bigger thing that signals to me that this is definitely pulling from Banjo-Kazooie too. And it is, and I quote bigger, because it is the dinosaur. That whole aspect, that whole world totally feels pulled from Banjo-Tooie, which is, I can't remember, is it like Dinosaur Land or something it's called in Banjo-Tooie, where you do the transformation from Humba Wumba, that's the new shaman in the game, or the fairy girl, I forget what she was is exactly, but she's the one that does the transformations, because in this game you get to actually play as Mumbo Jumbo, as a playable character. So Humba Wumba gives you the ability to turn into a friggin' T-Rex, and I'm like, looking at that, and obviously that is a cool big thing in Mario Odyssey, totally makes me feel like this Mario game is pulling from Banjo-Kazooie Tooie, which to me, you know, makes sense. Banjo-Kazooie Tooie, those are two of the greatest 3D platformers made. It was during the heyday of 3D platformers, the N64, PS1, Sega Saturn era, and it makes sense that they would look back, and not just for Super Mario games, but look back and see what worked in other games to make this Super Mario Odyssey the most fantastic, best 3D platformer of all time. No, Nintendo, that's what they want to do. They want to make it the greatest. There seems like a ton of content in this game. I can't wait to play it. And like I said, it just makes sense that they would pull from one of the greats and put this in this game. Now, there are a contingency of Nintendo fans who don't want to give credit to other 3D platformers like a Banjo-Kazooie. And I don't see any other platformers, 3D platforms especially, on the level of a Mario outside of Banjo-Kazooie. I feel like Banjo-Kazooie's, those games were near to on the level of a Mario, and I will give it credit maybe I'm a bit of a Rare fanboy who pines for that era, but I just feel like they were pretty close, and I don't think Miyamoto would be, you know, as pessimistic or as, like I said, possibly petty when it came to Rare if he didn't feel the heat from what they were doing. I think he felt like they challenged him on what he was great at, and the fact that they used his character to do it probably pissed him off a little bit, and I don't blame him for being a little petty, because that's a human, you know, a human thing. So but I'm going to give them credit because it was a great series, and it would make sense for any platformer, 3D platformer coming out today to look back at the greats. And Banjo-Kazooie-Tooie is one of the greats, and it would make sense for even Nintendo to want to pull from that, those mechanics from that great, those great two games. So let me know what you guys think. You think I'm onto something here? I think it's, you know, pretty obvious, but some people may be, you know, resisted, like I said, because they don't want to give credit where credit is due sometimes to other great platformers. But let me know in the comments below what you think. As always, thank you for watching and listening, and I'll see you fools next time. Peace out. Oh yeah, one more thing. Play Nintendo, fools.